Mr. Deputy Secretary General, would you please tell us which is exactly the purpose of your visit in Moldova?
Well, I'm here to discuss ways that we can expand our partnership with Moldova. Moldova, of course, has been a partner of NATO for more than 20 years, but in the wake of the crisis surrounding Ukraine and Russia's increased provocative behavior, NATO foreign ministers in April decided that we should step up our support for countries like Moldova, as well as for Ukraine itself, that are facing increased risks. So this visit was an opportunity for me to learn more about the situation here, to meet with all the political leaders, and to discuss the priorities for the next phase of NATO's partnership with Moldova, and also to underscore some political messages that we stand for Moldova's sovereignty, territorial integrity, and its independence.
Before trying to get into details about this, the next phase of relationships between NATO and Moldova, could you please tell us what's NATO's assessment about the development of the Ukrainian crisis and the regional crisis right now?
Well, we remain deeply concerned about ongoing efforts to destabilize the situation by Russia through a combination of support, direct and indirect, for the separatist forces through very aggressive and malicious propaganda from the Russian state media, support for clearly illegal and illegitimate referenda recently conducted in the East. At the same time, we have heard encouraging words from Russia regarding support for a political process and for a dialogue between the authorities in Kiev and the and leaders from the regions. So we hope that the latter will become Russian policy, and that Russia will, most importantly, support the very important presidential elections on the 25th of May. That is the key election that can provide a legitimate turning point toward the stabilization of the situation and restoration of respect for Ukraine's sovereignty and independence.
Speaking about these referendums that have been organized throughout Ukraine, destabilizing Ukraine and bringing the fear of federalization or any kind of separation. Does this have anything to do with your visit, for example, in Gagauzia? Is there any fear that Moldova could be destabilized by a similar scenario?
Well, we have seen lots of unexpected events in connection with Ukraine, and we can't completely rule out that there'll be efforts from outside the country to pursue similar strategies. But I think the key is for Moldova itself, the government, the leaders of regions like Gagauzia, to try to work these issues out among themselves and not take any unhelpful advice from outside actors. But I think that the referenda that took place in eastern Ukraine clearly have no credibility. All kinds of numbers have been cited for the turnout, for the numbers who voted for, which have been not substantiated by the facts and seem basically impossible to believe. The real election that we should be focusing on is the one on May 25th.
It is indeed very important, this this election. But in connection to that and to possible future developments, does NATO expect more from Russia on a military direction? Does NATO think that if the elections would not have the expected outcome for Moscow, would Russia step forward to a military action?
Well, it's always dangerous to speculate. It's clear that Russia has the capacity still in place along Ukraine's eastern borders to intervene militarily with very little warning, and we haven't seen the withdrawals that were announced a few days ago. So the capability is there. What we can't accurately predict is the intentions of Russia. But we hope that the responsible activities by the leaders in Kiev to reach out and offer a roundtable dialogue with leaders of the region, the efforts to assist in the holding of a free and fair election with sizable assistance from the OSCE and the presence of thousands of monitors will lead to a de-escalation on Russia's part, and let the Ukrainian people choose their own leaders. That's should be a principle that nobody should dispute.
Getting back to Moldova a bit, there is Transnistria, actually. A frozen conflict regarded by everyone right now as a possible source of dangerous developments in the future. How does NATO regard Transnistria right now?
Well, we have long supported Moldova's territorial integrity and have rejected any claims by the so-called leaders in Tiraspol to independence or any other status other than being a constituent part of Moldova. NATO isn't directly involved in the 5+2 process, but we certainly have given it our political support. In the current circumstances, we are concerned about a potential effort to stir up new trouble in Transnistria, to respond to the illegitimate appeals for annexation by Russia, which would be a very provocative step. But our focus is on supporting our partners here in Moldova in strengthening their own institutions, their own capacity, so that the country is less vulnerable to outside interference and meddling.
At the current moment, the Moldavian society is very much concerned about its security, the security of the state, actually. As you very well know, Moldova has declared itself as a neutral state, but it seems that neutrality is very vulnerable and Moldova is not really able to defend itself. And this is why some would ask, and I would ask you to tell us, if the current status of the partnership between Moldova and NATO does provide or does not provide any security guarantees on behalf of NATO for Moldova.
Well, I can give you a very clear answer. Partnership does not provide the hard, firm security guarantee that NATO members enjoy under the Washington Treaty, the well-known Article 5 that says that an attack on one is an attack on all. So our support for Moldova is less concrete in comparison to Article 5, but nevertheless we believe we can provide tangible assistance, political support. There is the right of any partner to seek emergency consultations with NATO if it feels threatened in a particular crisis situation. The focus is on helping Moldova defend itself by developing well-managed defense institutions, making the best and most efficient use of your limited defense resources, working to develop good partnership relations with neighboring countries through participation in international peace support operations and training and exercises. So it isn't the same as Article 5, but we believe we are supporting Moldova and sending a clear message of our solidarity.
Mm-hmm. You've been mentioning before the next phase of this partnership. Would you please give us some hints about what would that mean?
Well, we are in the midst of discussions now with Moldova on updating what's called the Individual Partnership Action Plan. Among the areas that seem to be of interest include strengthening the national security institutions, working to update Moldova's military doctrine, to continue to work on defense education and training. NATO has been helping to improve the military academy here in Moldova, direct participation in some NATO exercises, work on non-military issues such as civil emergency planning to deal with potential natural disasters, and we're continuing to work on the cleanup of toxic chemicals and pesticides.
I would ask you now, please, sir, if possible, to try to respond to some disinformation that goes on quite strongly here in Moldova. Some aggressively say that if Moldova would continue to follow its European vector, that would necessarily mean also integration in NATO. Mm-hmm. And this is considered as a major threat by the Russians, and some would say that this would inflict necessarily strong actions from Russia against Moldova. How would you comment on that, sir?
No, I've heard that, including the statement by Dmitry Rogozin a few days ago, that there's some kind of rule in that he's heard about that requires countries that seek EU membership also to seek NATO membership. There is no such rule. Each institution has its own policies and procedures for membership, but they have no relationship to membership in other institutions. So it's perfectly fine from the NATO point of view for Moldova to seek a closer association with the EU, and perhaps in the long term to seek membership of the EU, but to maintain a status of neutrality and just have a partnership with NATO. We have many neutral countries who are partners, who are not knocking on the door for membership, like Sweden and Finland or Austria and Ireland. This is, I think, just a part of a disinformation campaign.
Well, speaking about Mr. Rogozin and the declaration he makes, there was a strong declaration and a direct threat against Romania and Moldova. He was very upset by Romania and Moldova's attitudes, and he said that he would fly over Romania in a strategic mm-hmm. bomber. How is this regarded by NATO?
Well, it is a very provocative statement, and I believe our Romanian allies were correct in asking Moscow whether this was a statement of official policy or not. At the same time, we've grown accustomed to provocative and flamboyant statements by Mr. Rogozin. And obviously, don't take everything he says entirely seriously. But what he did in his recent visit to Transnistria and the collection of petitions regarding joining the Russian Federation was clearly a provocative act, and is not the kind of action one expects from a deputy prime minister.